this time of year when we begin to gather again from our dispersal, so to speak, during the summer. We begin to rethink our purpose and regear our ministries for a new season of activity. The early church was in its development. It was adding people all the time, and it was growing. And with that growth came added responsibilities. We read in the sixth chapter of Acts, verses 1-4, the following. In those days, when the number of disciples was increasing, the Hellenistic Jews among them complained against the Hebraic Jews because their widows were being overlooked in the daily distribution of food. So the 12, that is the disciples, gathered all the disciples together and said, "It would not be right for us to neglect the ministry of the Word of God in order to wait on tables. Brothers and sisters, choose 7 men from among you who are known to be full of spirit and wisdom. We will turn this responsibility over to them, and we'll give our attention to prayer and the ministry of the Word." Every growing church ever since has encountered the same problems as these. In fact, we often refer to them as growing pains. When the church grows, it changes, no matter how old or how long it's been around. The workload increases, and there is tension between newcomers and long-timers. I remember this very vividly with a church I founded and pastored for 19 and a half years. We started with about 60 people. When we began to really grow, everybody was excited. The sanctuary felt full and was full. The singing was louder. There were more kids in the Sunday school. There was more money in the offering plate, more resources. The first Sunday that we went, over 100 in attendance, everybody celebrated. But it soon became apparent that along with these new attendees came a new set of problems. Some of them weren't believers yet and didn't really know how to act in church. They clapped when they weren't supposed to.
Can you imagine?
And talked during the prelude. Some of them came with serious problems or suggestions about how to do things differently. More kids in the Sunday school meant the rooms were crowded. The teachers felt overwhelmed. When we took over a portion of Fellowship Hall to expand the nursery, some of the regulars complained that there wouldn't be enough room for dinners. As the only pastor, I was torn between following up on new people and making home visits to the more senior saints. I spent more time solving problems and counseling people and less time preparing sermons. We began to wonder if having 100 people was a good thing or not. Every growing church is going to have moments like this, when members are troubled, leaders are overwhelmed, and everything seems to be changing. How leaders and people respond to those moments determines whether the church will continue to thrive or whether it will settle into stagnation and the status quo. Thankfully, at this critical point in history, the apostles made a bold and innovative move. They decided to give away part of their ministry. If you look in verse 2 of our scripture, "It would not be right for us to neglect the ministry of the Word of God in order to wait on tables," they said. At this critical moment, the apostles realized that they couldn't meet everyone's needs, and in fact, they shouldn't even try. It wasn't that people's needs weren't important, and it wasn't that the 12 weren't above waiting on tables and distributing food. I'm sure they found it quite satisfying helping people, but what they came to realize was that by trying to do it all themselves, they were not only failing to keep up, but they were neglecting their primary responsibilities and were depriving other members of an opportunity to serve. So they decided to share the work of ministry with others. So they chose seven people from among them to do these other activities while they devoted themselves to prayer and the ministry of the word. And so with the help of the congregation, the seven people that they chose to care for widows and other practical needs raised a great burden off their shoulders. Now the word service doesn't appear in our English translation, but the Greek word for serving actually appears three times in the passage. And then in a symbolic act of empowerment, the apostles laid hands on the people that they had commissioned for ministry. And that decision would change forever the way God's work would be done in the world. From now on, ministry would be in the hands of the people. All the people. We begin to read about all kinds of things happening. Later in the chapter, Stephen begins to preach. Philip becomes an evangelist. In chapter 9, an up-and-coming leader named Saul gets into the mix. And later in chapter 9, another surprising thing happens. The first woman's name is mentioned in a ministry context. Dorcas, the seamstress, soon to be followed by Lydia, the church planter. Priscilla, the teacher. Philip's daughters prophesy. And with all these different responsibilities and gifts, there was a need to establish a working relationship. The scripture that Kathy read to you this morning from 1 Corinthians talks about that, about the interrelatedness of all the various parts of the body of Christ. It was the beginning of a new day for the church in which ministry would be placed in the hands of ordinary men and women who had been called and gifted by God to do His work in the world. So the result was tremendous. The word of God spread, the scripture says. The number of disciples in Jerusalem increased rapidly, and a large number of people came to be obedient to the faith. It was a vibrant, growing church because people were getting involved in ministry. The church was meant to be a life-changing experience. It was to be a place that values discipleship, a mission-driven church that values outreach, a spirit-filled church that values worship, a life-sharing church that values community. And the church was meant to be a service-based church where everyone exercises his or her God-given heart for ministry. As a church, if we want to do good in Jesus' name, serve more people in more places, we have to get better at helping believers discover and employ the gifts God has given them to serve others. This is not just for the church's benefit, but for the benefit of everyone, and particularly the individual, for you and for me. Because we know that one of the best ways to go deeper in your faith is to get involved in ministry. And one of the best ways to get closer to people is to serve together. Would you show the video, please, Dustin?
From drowning, been caught in a rip current. This all started when two boys got trapped in the current. Look at all those people there. Their mother and other family members jumped in to save them, but they got trapped themselves. A woman and her husband saw what was going on and then coordinated the rescue. She swam out to the family with a boogie board while her husband organized the human chain that brought them back to shore.
Beachgoers along the shores of Panama City Beach in Florida found themselves witness to an event as dangerous as it was inspiring. While playing in the water, two boys suddenly became caught up in a rip current and started screaming for help. And understandably, the boy's mother jumped in the water to try and save them, only to get caught herself. One by one, more family members came in after the group only to face the same predicament. After just a short time, the spectacle and shouts had attracted a number of onlookers, and there was a guy in the water saying, "Man, they're all stuck out there, the riptides pulled them out. If I tried to go out there, if I go any further, I'm going to get stuck myself," said witness Derek Simmons. But luckily, Simmons' wife, Jessica, did some quick thinking, gathered the help of those around them, and began instructing the people to grasp arms and to wade into the sea as a human chain. Anchored to the safety of the shore, as many as 80 people worked together in this fashion. And after a stressful few minutes, successfully pulled the swimmers to safety. It was the most remarkable thing to see, Jessica Simmons told reporters. These people who didn't even know each other, and they trust each other that much to get them to safety.